You want, yeah, you gotta read it again. Or we can always say you already read it once, but we won't do that. Okay, we have, next on our agenda is approval of resolution number 2018-08. Oh, excuse me, approval 2018-03, the preliminary PUD for Door Landing. And Ms. Cockcroft, we have the title again.
Resolution number 2018-03, resolution of the City Council of the City of Mount Door, Florida, approving a preliminary development plan, plan unit development entitled Door Landing, providing for the adoption of recitals and findings, providing for implementing administrative actions, providing for preliminary PLED master plan terms and conditions, providing for conflict severability and effective date.
Thank you, Ms. Hayes.
Thank you, Mayor, Council members. I'm going to ask Vince to come back up again and just kind of give you an update for this development, to give you the area that the development will be located in. Again, for the citizens mainly, I know that you have it in the packet, but this will just provide the citizens who may be listening to the recording some information. So thank you, Vince.
Thank you, Vince Sandersfeld, Planning and Development Department. The request in front of you for the presentation of the Simpson Family Partnership Limited and Simpson Fruit Company. And the applicant is Polis and Bennett LLC. The current property, this is an orange grove operation. This is a single family dwelling in a vacant lot. It's 129 single family residential dwellings on approximately 33.8 acres and developable 31.59 due to some right of way that exists on the property. This property is sandwiched between Pine Limit, and we go to Termaine, over to past Grand Views in the center, and then Clayton over on the east side. Several exhibits, an infill type, it's in our northeast CRA. We actually took it to the advisory committee. As these developments come into these infill areas, we try to advise feedback. We don't have any action on, but it's nice to see a board advisory committee give some feedback. Their main concern was how the housing type would look, how the housing would be formatted, some feedback that we took to the applicant. The basic format, we thought this would be an easy plan unit development. The request in front of you is a preliminary PUD. If this is so approved, then it moves to a final, and then they can start the construction plan process. So this is the first step of looking at an overall snapshot of changing the R2 district, which is a single family duplex district today. They could develop that as duplex or single family homes. They felt because of the nuances of the right-of-way on our Pine and Limit, there's a little area, and Grandview, how to massage the grid system. That was really our concern. This is existing neighborhood, established neighborhoods around, really, except a limit size more of the orange grove. So the concept was to develop a master plan with some conditions to be more beneficial as an infill project. And I think this project, as you see with the master plan, has several different conditions that you normally would see in the R2 district. These will be 50-foot wide lots, not 60. 5,500 square feet lots, not 7,000. And the setbacks will be 20 front, side, 5, 20, 10 rear. So there's some flexibility in the lot size and the placement of the home. Also, there's some issues with the center line of setbacks on Pine and Lemon. The living area under our code today is 750 square feet. They're proposing 1,200 square feet minimum. All homes are required to have a garage. The difference of this PUD is several dedications. There's four dedication areas of right-of-way, one on 20th, one on Clayton, Pine. There's a dedication of remaining Grandview Avenue and a county dedication of Lemon Avenue, this little strip of 33 feet they're proposing. Also, they're trying to design each home with Energy Star. That's consistent with our standard PUDs that you've seen before. And as they develop the street lights, and I think Charles just gave a presentation a couple months ago, would be decorative type, with fitting with the neighborhood, consistent with the Grandview. The focal point is a promenade. The Grandview Street, with the dedication of the right-of-ways, also include a common sidewalks, benches, walking trail along Grandview of the property, transcending through the property. So the highlight of the property and the highlight of the project is focusing on Grandview. So this master plan builds that in, and the conditions, and you see the details as the preliminary. Actually, from what you'll be seeing for preliminaries, this is pretty substantial. detail, but I think it couldn't tell the story of what you wanted to see in a preliminary, so staff asked for these clarifications on how to describe the project. And I think it helped us understand the 129 units and how that would fit the density, how that would fit the area. Another component is using the buffering around the perimeter. Our land development code actually says continue the grid. Take the waffle iron and mash it all together with this subdivision, but in looking at the existing neighborhoods and establishment, that might have been problematic because we're introducing a new subdivision, 129 lots with existing neighborhoods. It was better to use some buffering around the perimeter. The trees could then be planted in that. They could be planted in the promenade. They could be used for the home association common areas and use that as a benefit of more tree. And that's the offset of this master plan. So quick summarization, that's the master plan setup and an infill project. And the last component is a public arts contribution. The applicant is willing to make a donation of $37,500 into the public arts so they could use it wherever they prefer.
I move approval.
We have the same procedure we did last time.
I'm sorry.
That's
I
okay.
apologize.
That's
I
appreciate
okay.
it. And, so right now this is, I guess we can ask questions of the applicants. The applicant has a chance to make some comments. If the applicant is here and wants to make comments, right here, state your name and address, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Good evening, council members. I'm Kathy Hathaway with Polis & Bennett, 2602 East Livingston Street, Orlando, Florida. As Vince said, we've been working with staff probably about 6 months on this project. Lots of great back and forth dialogue. We're very proud of the project. We're bringing it forth to you this evening. We've asked for your approval and are available to answer any questions you have.
Thank you. Okay, now's the time for anybody from the public who wishes to address this PUD. Now's the time to come forward, state your name and address.
Trustee Styles, 2016 Donnelly Place. My property backs up to 20th, right at the corner of this proposed plan, the larger of the two stormwater management holes. Thank you. My only concern with this is because my property backs up right now to Orange Grove, so there's absolutely no noise and no trees and oranges, that they will consider planting a lot of trees and or some type of buffer to keep any additional noise, well, now new noise that we're going to have from this, all these houses and everything. So I just hope they'll replace all those trees that are coming out, at least with a lot of trees, as many as they can. Thanks.
Thank you.
Anybody else wish to address council on this issue? Okay, seeing none, it's open for a discussion with council now at this point. Ms. Tillett.
I just have a question, possibly for Vince. Sorry, I thought that was, it sounds like my ringtone, but I don't know what's off.
You're out there?
Along Grandview, the linear park and the 30-foot tree line buffer and 10-foot wide buffer, will there be also sidewalks extended up? Is that part of that linear?
Yes, ma'am.
There sidewalks definitely will be sidewalks.
For pedestrian, I kind of went through it quickly on that.
And will the cost of that be borne by the developer or by the city?
By the developer.
Okay.
Site improvements or developer costs.
Thank you.
I will say that the improvements going in down Grandview will actually change the current road that's a mini road to a regular size road, if you want to call it that, and connect to Limit and connect to the sidewalks that come down on that side of Limit, if I'm not mistaken.
That's correct.
There's some in that area.
And
so we will have some connectivity on a mobility perspective.
Is that on them or on us? Is that on the developer?
They're already developing the roadway down to Limit
the
properly. So it's on the developer.
Perfect.
Vince, could you give us a little bit more detail about the trees and landscaping buffers? I'm interested in Chrissy's question as well.
And a lot of it I'm referring to is their master plan, the colored sheet. You'll see along the perimeter on the south on Pine, there's a dedication of a 5-foot buffer, and that'll be tree lined, linear of soaring, and the dedication of right of way. 20th will be extended. They'll dedicate the ride. They will not put in the improvements. to the north of that is an additional property that's landlocked.
And it's not a berm, it's not an earthen berm, it's landscaping.
Landscaping, correct.
Okay.
And the component of Pine Street, they are providing a fence, and the idea was the homeowners would have different type of fence materials. That would be consistent, but it would be on the back side of Pine. You will not see it. The tree rows and landscaping will be facing the street. So if all homeowners come in and put fences, which they can do, then it won't be hodgepodge. It will be a consistent fence row hidden by the landscape. The main one is the Grand View, the main promenade, a 30-foot wide buffer on the east side and a 10-foot wide landscape buffer on the west side of Grand View. So as you drive up Grand View on your passenger side, as you're traveling north, you'll see a large linear park, benches, a walking trail, the sidewalks network going up to Lemon and connecting to the south with tree lined. And these will be canopy trees. These will be the live oak types specified to get that treescape feel. And then the last buffer around the reserve, some tree treatment vegetation.
Mr. Wilson?
Thank you, Mayor. I support this proposal for a couple of reasons. Number one, this is going to enhance, I believe, could be wrong, but my subjective judgment is it'll enhance the property values in that community, that Northeast community. And if that's the case, that would certainly be a value to those people living there. My first question is, that promenade, I think you've described that. Are we talking about a path that'll kind of be curvy, or is it a straight path?
Curvilinear?
Yeah.
Path?
Something more aesthetically pleasing.
That's fancy product right there.
Because that will certainly be a value, it seems to me, to the development. Then another question, Mr. Sandersfeld, is on Limit Avenue, and looking at page 68, is it 68? That gray area road to be dedicated seems to encroach into Limit, according to the plat.
Correct. That's missing little chunk. Since they have ownership directly to the south of it, they're going to dedicate that to the county.
I gotcha.
So they're going to obscure the right of way.
Over my head. No, I got it. I got it. Thank you. That's all I have.
I will also mention that Tremaine, as you know, is one of our walkways and bicycle routes, right? So this area will actually continue on through there. So there will be it's about a 30-foot, if I'm not mistaken.
There is a utility easement, but we're not going to plan the pedestrian at this time.
Correct, but you can still move through there. You can still go through there if you would like to continue on through. At this point in time, we're not asking that it be a 12-foot or a pavement, but there will be access through there. So eventually that's something we'll look at doing from the city perspective for bikes. Mm-hmm.
Mr. Tucker, you had your hand up before?
Yes, I did. Thank you, Mayor. To go back to Mr. Creel's question a little bit, 20th looks like it comes in down by the stormwater management area. Mm-hmm. So that's going to be tree-lined and buffered?
So as you're at 20th in Tremaine, which is at the far northwest corner of the project, there's a gray line that says right-of-way dedicated 25 feet from center line.
Yes, sir.
All the way to Grandview. And the concept is they'll dedicate 25 feet wide land to the city, so the property owner to the north, and they can develop their 25 feet at 50 foot right of way. So they'll continue 20th Avenue, they'll connect to Grandview. Because right now that parcel to the north that touches it does not meet land development code requirements for a right of way width. So they're contributing that extra 25 feet, and the Homes and Partnership, I believe, owns that track.
Thank you.
But to answer your question, we'll be landscaping around that stormwater pond, the perimeter of it, to provide that visual, along with the open space of the pond itself.
Yeah, so it doesn't look like there's a lot, except for the one just below there that comes into 19th.
Correct. So everything on that northern side is the stormwater management system.
All right. Thank you.
Any other comments from council?
No.
Okay, seeing none. Ms. Jones, can we have, can I have a motion for approval of resolution number 2018-03?
I move to approve.
Second.
Yes, second. Okay, fine. And Ms. Jones, can we have a roll call vote?
Ms. Tillett?
Yes.
Ms. Hopes?
Yes.
Mr. Ralston?
Yes.
Mr. Tucker?
Yes.
Mr. Crail?
Yes.
Mr. Massey?
Yes.
Mayor Jerome?
Yes. Approval of resolution number 2018-08, banking services. Ms. Cockcroft, could we have the title read, please?
Yes, sir. Resolution number 2018-08, a resolution of the City of Mount Dora, Florida, authorizing a piggyback contract for banking services with SunTrust Bank, providing for implementing administrative actions, providing for conflicts, providing for a savings provision, providing for severability, providing for conflicts, and providing for an effective date.
Thank you. Ms. Hayes?
Thank you, Mayor, Council members. Again, this is going through the process of making sure that all of our contracts are up to date. We have elected to present to you a piggyback agreement with SunTrust, who is our current bank. So we will not be changing banks or anything of the sort. We have the opportunity to piggyback with the City of Edgewater. They actually were able, when John McKinney was there, they were able to negotiate a very good return on any investments that we have there as far as on the interest rate. All other practices and processes remain the same. And we currently basically just continue operating as we do right now. So we would just ask that if you have any questions, we could answer those, but to approve this for our continued process, which would expire, in July of 2021.
You have a motion for approval?
So moved.
Second.
Any comments, questions from the council on this? Anybody from the public wish to address this item? Seeing none, Ms. Johnson, can we have a roll call vote, please?
Mr. Crail?
Yes.
Mr. Tucker?
Yes.
Mr. Ralston?
Yes.
Ms. Tillett?
Yes.
Ms. Hope?
Yes.
Mr. Massey?
Yes.
Mayor Jerome?
Yes. We have approval of resolution number 2018-09, partial acquisition for US 441 utility. Ms. Cockcroft, could we have the title read, please?
Yes, sir. And resolution number 2018-09, a resolution of City Council of the City of Mount Dora, Florida, approving the purchase of Gerald W. Patrick property, alt key 1447143, for utility relocation on US 441 from Lincoln Avenue to Donnelly Street. Provided for legislative findings and intent, providing their authority to the city manager for implementing administrative actions, providing for authority to the mayor to execute, providing for a savings provision, scrivener's errors, conflict, severability, and effective date.
Thank you, Ms. Hayes.
Thank you, Mayor. Council members, Mr. Peters is here. He could answer any questions you might have, but this, along with the last item that we brought you last week, if you remember at the very last meeting, we are going through the process and purchasing as required for the utility relocation part of US 441, but Mr. Peters can answer any your questions you might have.
Okay, can I have a motion for approval?
This I move resolution? Approval.
Second.
Sorry.
Okay. Any questions for Mr. Peters or Ms. Hayes? anybody from the public have any questions? Any comments on this issue? We need a mic. Walk down to you. You want to sit down?
No, I'm good. Okay. Mike Masterson, 7887 Crosswinds Way. Just a question in terms of process as to up north, we used to take land by eminent domain. And I wonder why this useless piece of land to the person who owns it has just turned into a $5,000 freebie to them. Why couldn't we have obtained it by eminent domain?
Mayor, can we turn to our city attorney for that?
Sure, go right ahead.
Because I'm aware of that process up north.
It'll cost you a lot more and it'll take a lot longer.
Okay, thank you.
That was my answer as well. If you think this is a sweetheart deal, we're able to go to eminent domain. The juries don't like that.
Yeah, well, I mean, I saw the amount of money we paid along the front of Renninger's for an easement, and that was outrageous, in my opinion, for just the opportunity to put a pipe across the front of their property. So, I put 4 kids through college. I'm used to pinching pennies, and so this seems like a waste of good money, expenditure of good money. But now you're telling me it's cheaper, okay.
Unfortunately, eminent domain is an extremely last resort
okay.
option for a city to ever use. Okay, we have that public. Anybody, any other comments from council? Seeing none, Ms. Johnson, can we have a roll call vote, please?
Mr. Robson?
Yes.
Ms. Hopes?
Yes.
Ms. Tillett?
Yes.
Mr. Massey?
Yes.
Mr. Crail?
Yes.
Mr. Tucker?
Yes.
Mayor Jerome?
Yes. Okay, we have final reading of ordinance number 2017-12. Ms. Cockcroft, can we have the title read on that?
Ordinance number 2017-12, an ordinance of the City of Mount Dora, Florida, amending the Land Development Code Section 1.8, clarify other city regulations to Section 2.5, clarify Planning and Zoning Commission quorum and hearings, Section 2.6, and I ran the wrong thing?
No.
Revised appeal time frame, Section 3.4.4, revised R2 zoning district front setback, Section 3.5.1, revised setback relief requirements, Section 3.5.22, revised boat dock standards located on Lake Gertrude, revised standards 6.3.10, service drive frontage roads, Section 7.13.2, revised design standards for fire flows, revised Chapter 7 standards utility construction specifications, and Mount Dora Code of Ordinance Section 90.110 to clarify the applicability for tree removal and protection, providing for legislative findings and intent, providing for public severability, codification, as well as the correction of service errors and effective dates.
Yes, thank you, Mayor, Council Members. As you recall, we presented this a couple weeks ago and discussed that these items were presented to the Planning and Zoning Commission and were approved, and there were no really significant major changes. A lot of it's cleanup and some minor items, so we would ask that you approve this and approve it and proceed. Can't talk tonight. Approve it and proceed. Thank you.
Have a motion to approve this final reading of ordinance 2017-12.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Any comments from council?
Yes, Mayor. Thank you. Did you say there were some changes to the first reading?
There were not. No, presented as we gave you during the first reading presented.
All right. Thank you.
Anybody from the public wish to address the council? Seeing none, Ms. Johnson, can we have a roll call vote, please?
Mr. Crail?
Yes.
Mr. Robson?
Yes.
Mr. Massey?
Yes.
Mr. Tucker?
Yes.
Ms. Tillett?
Yes.
Ms. Hope?
Yes.
Mayor Jerome?
Yes. And now to discussion items on resolution number 2018-05. Ms. Hayes, we want to start that off?
Yes, thank you, Mayor and Council Members. I would just like to kind of start off with the fact that we brought this to you now two meetings. This is our third meeting to discuss short-term rentals and the B&Bs in the City of Mount Dora. The draft resolution I would like to address first quickly. The draft resolution, as was requested from Council to our City Attorney, and she can definitely answer any of the questions, really is a composite of a lot of different cities. It was asked of us, I believe, at that point in time for the City Manager and the City Attorney to get together and put in to a ordinance of some type or resolution. In this case, basically the whole kitchen sink, anything we could find, let's put in there and let's consider it. So we understand that there may be some items in this resolution that you may wish to pull out. I would encourage you at this point in time to go through each of the whereases, state your side of that perspective, and let's remove what does not need to be there and let's add in what we might need to. I would also like to mention that we did provide you some information, a little bit of information anyway, on the fees paid by the bed and breakfast, because I believe we left it in the public to believe that a lot of the fees that the B&B pay are really generated from the city, and they're not. They from what we show here, the annual renewal business tax is $30, the county business tax $30, annual fire inspection $30. There are some county tourism development taxes, and there's some state requirements on their side. They could better tell you those than I could, because I have not had to apply for those. But the fact that there's a lot of fees for them to be able to operate in business, the fees are not the city generated fees. So we provided those fees to you so that you could at least see those and discuss those with whomever might wish to bring up the fees. And we have provided you some further emails and so forth, I believe, from other other folks who have been part of the short term. So at this point in time, we just really like to talk about whatever the council wishes to talk about, but especially in relation to the a resolution, if that's what you wish to.
Strictly just discussion tonight, correct?
Yes, sir. We'll bring the resolution back to the next meeting once you've told us what you wish to have in the resolution, if we're at that point tonight.
Okay. I'm going to recognize Ms. Oakes first. Hands up, because...
Yeah, I only have one point of clarification before the discussion starts. Our discussion is about short-term rentals, but in the summary, it's referred to as Airbnbs, and that, I think I heard before, is a specific company.
Yeah.
That's correct. So we'll change it to short-term.
So we can clean this and take that out and always refer to them as short-term rentals, mm-hmm. correct?
Yes, ma'am.
That's all I wanted, because I saw that in several places.
Okay. Mr. Olson,
thank you.
And then Ms. Tull.
Thank you. Thank you. I'd like to suggest we delete several of the whereases. It's loaded with whereases, and I'd like to, and I understand the reason, very valid. But the purpose of this is to inform our legislative representatives and senators of the position of the council. And if I know them, they will skip through most of the whereases and they'll look at the now therefores. But we do have to do that. I have one question that I would like to ask Ms. Cockcroft, if I can, before I make these suggestions, and that is, toward the end in the title, do we need in a resolution of this type all the providing for saving provisions and all of that? Is that a necessary thing?
No, really, you're not taking any action. You're right. Just making a policy statement, basically. And also, one of the people sort of had asked, you know, is it subject to appeal? This isn't, you're not really taking any action, so it's not a calendar ordinance or any contract. It's really just a statement of policy.
Right.
So
I would recommend 23, I'd recommend eliminating. And number 24, the next following one.
Promotes tourism.
City of Mount Dora.
I lost you at 24. Which one, how does that read?
Whereas the city of Mount Dora promotes tourism, including appreciation and enjoyment of the city's abundant.
Okay. This goes back in, this is just my suggestion. And then on page 4, on section 6 of the now therefore clause, mm-hmm. recitals, of the, recital, whatever that is. The directions to the city clerk, there should be a comma after city clerk. And I'm not sure, again, about section 7, 8, and 9, unless, Council, you want to keep that in there.
I would like to leave Scrivener's errors just because I believe
that's
it protects
fine.
All of us.
That's fine. Then if we can go back to the one that I had some amendments to, it says, whereas over the past years.
What number?
Which
page?
Page
3 of 4.
I got it. Okay.
Which would be the third one from the top.
Mm-hmm. Here, Jennifer.
19, okay, I think. Third from the top? 19.
Yes.
The 19? Okay. I haven't numbered them, I'm sorry.
And you would modify that?
Then on the second line, it says there are approximately blank short-term rentals.
Right.
I recall the discussion at the last time, there were 205. And is that?
Well, that's a number that's on the internet. It counts. So I would be hesitant to say that's the actual number. We don't know that. So I would just caution.
Here's
up to
approximately.
We could say approximately 200, and then if the next line reads short-term rentals, then I would add nationally advertised as available in the city of Mount Dora.
Yes.
So after the rentals, you would add nationally advertised as available. And then at the end of home away, comma, yet only approximately 25 are licensed by the Florida Department of Business and Professional Regulation as required by law. Is that true?
Can you email me that?
Pardon me?
Or I'll get it from then. I lost track of writing it all.
Okay.
As for the licensure, how many do we find licensed?
And at the end of the
as of this date, 25.
At the end of home away, which is the last words, it would be a comma, yet only approximately 25 are licensed by the Florida Department of Business and Professional Development, Regulation rather, as required by law. That's the thing that I learned last time about, kind of surprised me a little bit, that
there's a requirement, apparently, as I take from the audience of the last meeting, that if you are going to have one of those entities here, you have to be licensed by the BNDR. And if that's the case, and that's why I mentioned last time, the state's attorney or somebody in DBR needs to know about that and should know about that to make sure that those regulations are followed in Montour. We shouldn't be that easy. We should be requiring our to be competitive with those that do follow that. And speaking of the urns that spoke last time, they follow that law, as they reported. That's a disadvantage to them not to require other competitors of theirs not to be regulated or registered. So those are my comments. I just suggest we consider in support of the resolution.
Ms. Miller?
Okay.
Thank you.
So thank you. My comments are, I don't have any problem with, there was one, I think, of yours that I did, but it's, I'm looking on a screen, I don't have a hard copy, so I can't really remember.
Page 152, fourth, whereas, up from the bottom, where it says, whereas City of Mount Dora promotes tourism, that was your comment?
Yeah, I think so. I think we want to also tell them why we are so, you know, interested in this. And actually, I have an email from the Urns, and they actually also had recommended adding in three new whereases. The first one was, whereas the City Council does not desire to prohibit short-term rentals within the City of Mount Dora, but instead seeks to restore home rule, allowing the city to impose reasonable restrictions on short-term rentals.
I can support that.
So that language, I think, was not only tells the legislature, you know, that we want our home rule, it also, I think, reassures the owners of short-term rentals that we are not intending to prohibit them. We simply want to be them to be legal, and we want to know who they are and where they are, and ensure that they are safe. Level the playing field, that they are safe places to stay, and that they are compatible with the neighborhoods, you know. That one, and then whereas the City Council reiterates their commitment to private property rights, I'm not sure whether that really needs to be in there or not. Whereas the City Council reiterates their commitment to private property rights. This went to everybody, by the way. This went to everybody. The third one, though, I think is important. It says, whereas the City Council recognizes that the City of Mount Dora plays host to numerous events, that current hotel and bed and breakfast lodging is not sufficient to satisfy the accommodation needs of visitors, and that short-term rentals play a part in satisfying the need for lodging to accommodate visitors to the City of Mount Dora. In other words, it's recognizing that, again, that we are not attempting to prohibit this through, you know, zoning or anything, zoning changes or anything like that, but that we need this to be a collaborative effort. So I'm just going to throw those out.
I gave the email to the city attorney that you're speaking of. Can you just quickly, second page? That is on page 152 or page 3, fourth up. It says City of Mount Dora promotes tourism, including appreciation and enjoyment. That was just
right.
One that
and that one, I think perhaps that one could be replaced. I think this one is better written. This the one that Rob and Terry wrote. It was better written. Rob wrote.
And can you state which ones on the second page you preferred, Ms. Tillett? Because on the out of the ones on the email, was it items number 1 and 3?
1 and 3.
I just wanted to make sure the city attorney.
Yeah, items
that.
1 and 3 on the email.
On the email, Jennifer.
Correct.
Page 2, items 1 and 3.
Yes. Number 2, I don't think it's.
Okay, good. Now going.
Thank you.
My next thing is going to page 151, verse 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th, 6th, the 7th one down where it says, whereas short-term vacation rentals located in residential neighborhoods can create disproportionate impacts related to their size, excessive occupancy, and the lack of proper facilities, theft unregulated. Does that mean left? Should that be the word left? Okay. I don't want to delete that whereas. I don't want to delete that clause. I just want to correct it. The last one on that same page where it says, whereas traditional lodging establishments, hotels, motels, and bed and breakfasts are restricted to non-residentially zoned areas, that's not true here for the bed and breakfasts. I don't believe it's even true for our hotel downtown. Well, no, that's sort of a non-residential area, but bed and breakfasts are in residential areas. So I think we should either delete that whole thing or rewrite it.
When in doubt, delete it.
Okay, and I had the approximately. On page 3 of 4, the second one from the bottom, whereas the city desires to encourage short-term vacation rentals that are safe, fit with the character of the neighborhood, that's not one that you took out, is it?
No.
Okay, all right, good. And my final comment is on page 4 of 4, section 3, support for home rule authority, change 2017 to 2018. And that's all I have.
Who's the tech here for those? Mr. Tucker.
Okay, when I read this, and I think just coming from my background, a lot of it, 2 and 2 didn't add up to 4 in a lot of these, to be quite blunt about it. When I say 2 and 2 didn't add up to 4, let's see, number, if you go to page 151, okay, paragraph 5, going down the page, where short-term rental occupants, due to the transient nature of their occupancy, are unfamiliar with local hurricane evacuation plans, by God, and the location of fire extinguishers, resident exit routes, pool and home safety features, and other similar safety measures that would readily be provided to guests of traditional lodging. I have never checked into a hotel and given a hurricane evacuation plan or any of the other.
It's on the door.
Eliminated.
It's what?
Door.
It's on the back of the door.
Yeah. Well, regardless, I've never looked for a hurricane evacuation plan. I have never gone to a place going, my God, there's a hurricane coming. I wonder where the hurricane evacuation plan is. A lot of these, in my opinion, just don't. We're making great leaps. I'll go through the ones that I want eliminated. Yeah. On page 151, and a lot of these, Mr. Rawlson may have mentioned already, just going numerically by page. Page 151, paragraph 5, paragraph 6, paragraph 7, 8, 9, 10, and 11. On page 152, paragraphs 1, 4, 5, and 9.
Those are all of mine.
Yeah. So I said, yeah, I apologize, Mr. Rawlson. You went, I didn't have them numbered, so I didn't mean for the redundancy. But I don't see where, like I said, some of what we're proposing, going, you know, 2 and 2 here is not adding up to 4. We can't make these assumptions that are, because one thing is this way, it's going to affect it another way. As I told the city manager when we discussed this, that if you want to eliminate divorce in this country, eliminate marriage. And this appeared to be what we were saying in some of these whereases. I just did not like it. I firmly believe with what Ms. Tillerson and Mr. Ralston said, that, and the Earns, I think the Earns did a great job last week in making, giving a second side of the story, that all the vacation rentals need to be licensed. But it's, and we can make that a level playing field. I'm not familiar with any vacation rental. I've stayed in a number of them, and I'm involved with one, that serve alcohol, that provide food, or any of these fees that the bed and breakfasts have to pay. You know, I empathize with them. I'm sorry they have to pay $1,500 or $2,500 or $3,000 for a license to serve food or alcohol, some of the major payments that they. But, you know, in the number of, you know, Airbnbs I've stayed at, I've rented homes, I've rented rooms. It's, you know, never have I been approached about food or alcohol or anything like that. So we can make it a level playing field to a degree on what we can do. But getting rid of some of these major fees that they have to pay, I, you know, I empathize with them, but they're paying the state on that. They're not paying us. But like I said, I agree with Mr. Ralston about some of the whereases here.
A comment if I may?
I'm good. I agree with comments that have been made.
This can be called down to a two-pager if we need to. The main thing that the whole purpose of this is to let the legislature know we oppose home rule attacks. And this is an attack on home rule rights in Mount Dora and 423 other cities. And so it's really important. I think we're going to present this at the next council meeting for final approval. We can certainly do it now with those changes. I'm fine with moving forward. The sooner the better, but.
I'd rather see it rewritten. Sure. Well, everybody's eliminated and
everything. I agree.
Some of us work from the computer.
But the important thing is to know that unless we stand up as cities and speak in opposition to their repeated and regular attacks on our rights and our residents' rights for home rule, it's going to go against home rule. So that's the whole purpose of doing this in any way that'll work to support it, to evidence that it's fine with me. Thank you.
I agree. However, some of the whereases I think need to be left in there for emphasis to the legislature and sort of like, this is why we are opposing your preemption of our home rule on this matter. You know, like, these are our neighborhoods, these are our citizens that may or may not be impacted, but if we don't have the ability to regulate, then we're going to send, you know, call Tallahassee for during the 60 days that you're in session and complain about the, you know, the B&B or not the B&B, but the Airbnb or the short-term vacation rental that's got, you know, 60 people in there over a weekend. So we need to tell them why, that we understand our neighborhoods.
I would agree with that, with the proviso that we document it. Right now, when talking to the chief, he's got no complaints of noise. He's got no complaints of alcohol abuse. He's got no complaints of anything. If we're going to present something and we're going to say that because of this, we have to have proof that we've had 60 people in a place over the weekend.
See, I disagree. I don't think we need to wait until something happens. I think we need to be proactive on this. We're not saying that this has happened. You'll see the word may in there. In other words, this may impact the quality or the peacefulness of this neighborhood, whatever the words are. It's a way to tell them that we
are concerned about these certain features of our municipality. That's all. I mean, I agree that some of them are not necessary. I will say, I don't know whether the hurricane evacuation thing is that could very well be a state law that you have to have.
Oh, there may be.
You know, on the back of the door. I mean, in Korea, on the back of your door is what to do if the north comes over the border. That's in every hotel in Seoul. So, you know, I mean, everything's relative.
Yeah, fully want a strong letter to go up there, but if we're going to, I simply want documentation in there that we've had this problem, we've had that problem, not we may have that problem.
We don't have that problem.
We don't, no.
We never have those problems, but we should have the ability to handle these problems, to plan for these problems, to have a process in place in order to avoid the problems.
Let me suggest something.
When it comes back to us, can it come back with the ones we moved redlined and with the two additionals added in, so that once we get the completed document, we can make sure we didn't eliminate something we didn't want to once we see it all?
Why don't we give you a redlined version and a clean version so you can see both of them, and that way you've got the clean for the meeting, but the redlined to see everything.
Yes, that's good.
Like
yes.
A Word document with redlined?
Oh, yes. Oh, yeah. Oh, yes. We'll do that.
I agree with that. Mayor? Thank you. I think what...
7 left and 2 added.
Okay. So
what?
What you're saying is, if you go to page 2, which I think is page 151, which is the 1, 2, 3, 4th whereas from the bottom, it says short-term vacation rentals located within established neighborhoods can disturb the quiet enjoyment, which is a true statement. And I can tell you, I've heard at Florida League Cities meeting where, now it's mainly happens in this coastal areas, but we're a destination city as well. So in those destination cities and coastal areas where there's been a vacation rental next door to a resident that is not a vacation rental, he or she can't even get into their property because the roads are blocked. They are picking up beer cans and all of that at 8 in the morning, and it is her property values, according to her report and her documentation from experts, is that her property value has dropped by $100,000 just because of one Airbnb next door that was unregulated. So we can say that it can disturb the quiet and enjoyment of the neighborhood. That's never going to happen, I don't believe, in Mount Dora with the quality of the people we have here, but we have to be as alert to that. And so I think it's okay to speak to you, Mr. Tucker, something in there that we can't necessarily prove, but has been assured from other people that have told us this has happened. But I think we have to be careful. And I like Ms. Hoax's idea of getting a clean copy or a redlined copy.
I agree with what Ms. Toll said about that, and that's great, and I like that, and what we need to do there. Ms. Hayes has a couple of comments as well.
I think, first of all, City Attorney wanted to clarify something before I read this, so item number 12, is that what you're asking about?
Mr. Tucker recommended be eliminated. Ms. Tillett recommended, there was a typo, but then also some discussion about can. So are we leaving 12 or striking 12?
Which number goes that one?
Page 153.
2.
1, 51, 1, 2, 3, 4, complete paragraph from the bottom. Fourth complete. Whereas short-term vacation rentals located in residence. So the fifth whereas up from the bottom? No, the fourth.
The one you just read.
The one you're talking about with the typo, the theft typo? I would like to leave that in, and as well as the one right underneath it. But like I said, we can...
Flip a coin.
We'll put them in. Jennifer, let's leave them in, and then let them next week decide finally when you're able to look at it, 2 weeks.
So leave in that one and the next one?
We'll see it all with a redline version.
You will.
I'm my battery died, so I don't have these in front of me. But I do think we need to be careful the more, and I think Mr. Robson said this probably better than I, but the longer and more verbose it is, the weaker it is. The fewer the words, hit the high points and leave the minutia out, because it's more powerful.
I'd like to underscore that, if I might. I can assure you, friend, in my background, my experience, they might look, maybe the staff will look at some of the whereases, but they will skip through that and look to the body of it. And they don't have the time to analyze it as we're doing now.
Well,
so
we went
shorter
27
the
to 9, so I'd say we went down pretty good.
Yeah.
Last February 7th, we presented to you through council's request, I have to assume, Resolution 2017-23, a resolution of the City Council of the City of Mount Dora, Florida, urging the Florida Legislature to support legislation restoring local regulatory authority with respect to the short-term rentals of properties, providing for legislative findings and intent, providing for implementing administration actions, and so forth. No whereases, two-page document. It does state in Section 2, the City Council of the City of Mount Dora does not, however, support the banning of vacation rentals, but urges all members of the Florida Legislature to restore the home rule authority of local governments and repeal any state law preempting the regulation of vacation rentals. We also discuss in another section support legislation that restores local regulatory authority to municipalities with respect to short-term rental properties in order to preserve the integrity of our neighborhoods and communities, as well as the high quality of life of our citizens. So in 2017, February of last year, almost a year to the day, we did present to the Tallahassee that the City of Mount Dora does, you know, take into it. Yes. So this will not be our first one that we're submitting to the state. So this will be our second resolution discussing not just home rule, but of course short term as well as.
I like the simplicity of that too.
Did anybody ever reply to our resolution that we sent?
No. We filed. Just so that you know.
Yes, at least thank you for your resolution. Yes.
By the way, when and if this is passed, I intend to personally talk to both Senator Babson and Representative Sullivan, and maybe if I can do it in a personal visit, they like that the best, and that's the most effective, so I may do that, depending on the time that I've got. And then we sent it to the Florida League of Cities anyway, and that's good, because they need to know, with the group of all of the others that are doing this, what kind of power they have to say that to the legislators when they do the testifying.
We sent a certified copy to Lake County Legislative Delegation, Governor Rick Scott, Senator President Joe Negron, okay. Speaker of the House, Richard Corcoran, okay. The League of Cities, Lake County, Lake County League of Cities. We stressed both of them for some reason. And then the Florida City County Management Association and Chairperson of Lake County Commission. So we did send it around.
Okay, just add on this one then the Florida League of Mayors also.
Good.
Okay.
Good idea.
Because they're also requesting this kind of action.
Well, our chairman of this council is on that board. So.
Is he?
Yeah.
I understand.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. That's all we need on this?
That is it.
Okay. So we're down to the city manager for some updates from you.
So the normal monthly report is there for you to review, with normal accomplishments. The lobbyists, we've put in the document. You also have the December 18th update, and I will re-forward you the one from today in a different format so that you can receive that. I also received, I believe, one later this afternoon, so there'll be two in the documents I send out to you. There is a city attorney report that I put in there and updated that. I did highlight a A new paragraph cleaned up some of the other, but it basically reads the same. It just says, in the upcoming months, City Council will need to address the April 10, 2017 motion for a certified attorney within 12 months representing the city. During the February 2018 work session, staff will add an item to the agenda for discussion with an expected outcome of a resolution in late February or early March 2018, as the council decides and desires. So that is just an upcoming. I just wanted to make a point to let you know that we've addressed that. And I believe, let's see if there's anything else at the end of this. That is it on that. I don't believe at this point in time that I have anything else. You should receive the monthly financials in your box. So if you did not, let me know. But we had those available. They're also on the website. So if you did not receive a printed copy because maybe you didn't mention it to myself or to John McKinney, let me know. We'll be glad to print a copy out for you. Otherwise, it's electronically. It's on the website. And I have... Councilmember Rolfson asked that I give you the directions and how you might be able to contact your legislator. So I'll put that in your box tomorrow. And let's see, Art Festival 2018 Art Festival Shuttle Service. So just give you an update. Preparation for the 2018 Art Festival. The following arrangements have been coordinated for shuttle service. There are 4 25 passenger buses that have been coordinated to transport attendees from the parking locations of the Mount Dora Country Club and the Lincoln Sports Park, and of course that'll be on the website. We have 12 six-seater carts that have been secured that will assist in transporting attendees from the downtown areas to the event, which is many more than we have in the past. We have 3 message boards that have been reserved to notice folks who are visiting to get them to come to the right parking lots, and that's just because it's visual, it's out there, so that was suggested. That's where we're going. What we're going with this time. In addition, a preliminary meeting with a volunteer program has occurred. It was on January 10th, and with the event discussion, registration as tent attendees and shuttle drivers. We again this time are working with the Boy Scouts and several other programs so that they can allowing them to charge for the parking in our parking lots, allowing them to earn their revenue. But of course, we're transporting at no cost in the shuttles. I think that's it, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Any questions for City Manager? Okay. City Attorney's Report. Scott Croft.
Just been working on what you asked me to, and I have my list.
All right. And we go on down the line here. Mr. Massey.
I'll be brief because we've been lengthy tonight. I'll be attending the Florida League of Cities training for newly elected municipal officials over the weekend.
Mr. Crail.
No pens.
Ms. Tilly.
I'm going to keep mine really short, too. I just want to let everybody know that tentatively scheduled on April 1st, the Community Trust is hosting a community ice cream social. For anyone in the community, it'll be at
April 1st.
Yeah,
Easter. April 1st is Easter Sunday, is it not?
Is it really?
Yes.
You're kidding. Yeah, well, I may have to get with cancel that date. In the near future, the Community Trust will be hosting probably not on Easter Sunday, hosting a community ice cream social to kind of get the word out to the average Jane Q citizen.
Have ice cream with a Yuri string.
Yeah. About, well, a lot of people have plans with
I know, I'm
plans, so, just so that the average person gets to, you know, more introduced to the Community Trust and what they do and how they benefit the community. That's all I have.
Okay, great. And Mr. Wilson.
Thank you. The urns left, but they reminded me of others, Christy and others, that appear periodically and give input to the council, may or may not agree, but I'm always impressed, usually impressed, not always, with the integrity of those that appear before us. We are treated with respect, I feel, and we have a duty to treat them with respect and hear and listen to what they say. So The urns provided me with a lot of input and information that were helpful to me. They were not rabid on one side or the other. They were very straightforward, and I truly value that. I wish they were here to hear that, but I really appreciate that. Among the others that have appeared before us, I don't mean to single them out necessarily. And lastly, our manager said, check your box up in the administrator's office. The two-pager that you will have is just a handy-dandy way to punch some things and connect with our legislators, and then do an own little quick email or a canned one, whatever is easy for you. But the important thing is to try to respond when you can, at least to our two representatives and legislators and the senators, Baxley and Sullivan, and anybody else in Lake County for that matter. And that helps, so I just wanted to try to make it easy. The Florida League of Cities makes it just kind of a no-brainer to be able to do that. And other than that, thank you very much. It was a long but, I think, productive council meeting tonight. Thank you.
Mr. Tucker?
I will be very quick. I will follow Mr. Crail's footsteps wherever he goes. I'll pass.
Ms. Hoax?
Ditto.
Okay. Mr. Drill, that's me. Okay. Mr. Peters, you would like to come on up and introduce? Oh, excuse me. John.
Chief.
The chief, John. I'm sorry. Oh. I thought you said Peters. I'm sorry.
That's okay.
Wrong.
Corporal Howe has been with the Mount Dora Police Department for going on 10-ish years. She is a native from this area. She used to be our Northeast CRA community officer. So she's very well-versed in the CRAs. And so there was life before Ivy. And it was Jessica, and so she's excited to learn how to ride a Segway. But she's coming to the downtown with a lot of energy. She knows a lot of people, so I think she's the perfect fit to come right in here and liaison between the businesses and the city going forward, the parking issue and all the other issues that the CRA has. She'll be the mouth and the legs for that. So, would you like to say anything?
Just that I'm very excited, and I look forward to the position developing and helping the downtown district in any way I can.
Super.
Real quick on the fence.
It will include Highland Street, and we do have the merchant meeting on the 22nd, which she will be there for the merchant meeting.
I come from a background where I always like to make sure that for a person to do a good job, they need your proper equipment to do your job.